The case of Jesus offers us insight into understandings of resurrection in the ancient world, and in particular, among those sources that are represented within the New Testament. And we'll be exploring them during both this series, leading up into Advent, and then early in the new year during the Lenten series, because we're dealing with a very large number of sources that reflect a conviction of Jesus' resurrection. In each case, we need to understand what is the basis of that conviction and how resurrection is conceived of. In order to do that, we need to begin with a sense of context. This also is provided by our sources and, very happily, by Greco-Roman historians who inform us in regard to the death of Jesus, and that leads us then also to consider what I am calling today, and I promise to explain the designation very soon, ear witness testimony. But first, the death of Jesus. What produces that? In the series that culminated in the spring of this year, we had brought Jesus to the point where Herod Antipas, who was the governor of Galilee, made the decision that he wanted to have Jesus killed. He wanted him killed for straightforwardly political reasons. Jesus had been a disciple of John the Baptist. John the Baptist preached again against Herod Antipas, claimed that his marriage was illegitimate, and therefore also that his very rule was not authorized by the Torah. As a result, Herod Antipas had had John the Baptist killed, and then he discovers that Jesus was developing an even larger following within Galilee. This results in Jesus' decision initially to use camouflage in the shape of the people we call apostles. But the people we call apostles are simply called in Aramaic, shaliachim, agents, people you send in order to represent yourself. You would send a shaliach, for example, if you were a landowner and you wished to finalize a deal and could not be present yourself. Jesus used his shaliachim in order to represent himself and his message in the towns and villages of Galilee. They provided him with camouflage. It was impossible to know where at a given moment Jesus actually was. This also explains why at this point within his ministry, Jesus travels very widely to the very limits of Israel. He crosses the Sea of Galilee to the east. He makes his way west towards Phoenicia. And yet he remains within Israel because Israel in its territorial inheritance is for him where the kingdom of God, as he referred to it, was going to be realized. That's also what caused his decision to make his final visit, as it proved, to Jerusalem. The point of going to Jerusalem was that within the temple there, in the context of sacrifice, the prophets, especially the prophet Zechariah, had promised that the kingdom of God would be revealed not only over Israel, but over all the nations of the earth. When he went to Jerusalem, however, he didn't find a suitable ground for the practice of worship on that inclusive basis. Instead, what Jesus found was the high priest of the time, whose name was Caiaphas, had centralized worship to a unique degree. He had actually set up vendors of animals inside the temple so that people would acquire their sacrificial offerings there. That was a departure from previous practice. Previous practice had it that when you went to Jerusalem, if you didn't already have an animal for sacrifice, you would acquire it in a place called Chanut in the Kidron Valley. Chanut in Aramaic simply means market stalls. You went to the marketplace. You acquired your animal there, and then you led it up yourself into the temple. Caiaphas' reform short-circuited all of that and guaranteed that the high priesthood had immediate control over every sacrificial activity within the temple. What Jesus did, therefore, in protest, by occupying the temple with enough of his followers that they could throw out the vendors and the animals, was to assert a prophetic principle against the priestly principle that Caiaphas was a fierce advocate of. The two of them were, in their differing ways, inspired by the inheritance of Israel, but they were also at loggerheads. When Jesus went to Jerusalem, he knew that there was going to be opposition to his views. When he actually occupied the temple, he clearly understood that there was going to be fierce opposition from Caiaphas and the high priesthood as a whole, which had resources of its own in the shape of temple police. But what Jesus did not know and could not have known was that a realignment of power in Rome had changed the whole equation in Jerusalem in ways that no one could have foreseen at the time. So let us make a little shift now from Jerusalem to Rome, and particular to the autumn of the year 31. The same season, the same year that Jesus is in Jerusalem. At that time, there came to a climax a power struggle between two people. One was the emperor, Tiberius, who was famously taking very long vacations in Capri. And the other was the head of the Praetorian Guard, whose name was Sejanus. Sejanus had made his way by taking over more and more of the day-to-day administration of the empire from Tiberius. At first, in the guise of someone who was helping the emperor. But then the suspicion arose that, in fact, Sejanus wished to supplant the emperor. Ultimately, Tiberius himself came to exactly that conclusion. And on the 18th of October, in the year 31, Tiberius sent a letter to the Senate. And this was an accusation against Sejanus for treason. He was taken to the Mamertine dungeon. While he was held a prisoner there, members of his family were killed. He himself was garrotted. His body was taken outside the Mamertine dungeon, and it was dismembered by a crowd. For all the reputation of the Roman Empire for due process and a concern for justice, state terror always lurked just below the surface and often broke out. Now, why should these events in Rome be so important for what happened to Jesus in Jerusalem? That concerns Pontius Pilate, because Pilate had been a protege of Sejanus. And like Sejanus, Pilate was an anti-Semite. One of Pilate's first official acts when he was appointed as being the prefect, as it was called, procurator is a later term, he was the prefect of Judea, was to march into the area of the temple court and to have his soldiers display Roman shields which had the image of the emperor on them. In other words, he introduced idols into the temple. On another occasion, very famously, he actually stole money from the temple treasury in order to build an aqueduct. So as long as Sejanus was in power, Pilate could engage in this kind of behavior with impunity. But with Sejanus out of the way, Pilate suddenly has to make common cause with the high priest in order to survive. And being a politician, that is precisely what he does. Caiaphas, in his dispute with Jesus, designates Jesus as being a threat to the order of Jerusalem. Rome was always fiercely concerned with the issue of being able to show that it could control the temple peaceably so that its Jewish subjects would remain in submission to them. In fact, the Roman emperor personally paid for sacrifices in the temple. The concept was, if the Roman emperor paid for the sacrifice, when you offered it, you were implicitly accepting Roman governance and praying for the prosperity of the empire and the emperor himself. So once Pontius Pilate makes common cause with Caiaphas, this what brings about a situation where the actual arrest of Jesus is by the Roman army, not merely by the temple police, and why Jesus' death is crucifixion in particular. Others in the Roman Empire had the power of capital punishment. You might, if you were a king, decapitate someone who was a victim. You might, if you were a local court, especially within Judea and Galilee, execute someone by stoning. No one would stop you. But crucifixion was understood to be a uniquely Roman prerogative. It was the way that it showed, by a symbol of terror, how much strength and authority it had. This by itself shows how implausible some attempts to explain the resurrection have become. One of them, for example, suggests, and you find this argued to this day, perhaps Jesus really didn't die on the cross. Difficulty with that, and the factor that makes that implausible, is that although the Romans were not omnicompetent, they did know how to kill people. They understood what crucifixion was supposed to do and when it had achieved its result. I was taking part in an interview just the other week for a program which will air, I think, sometime during the spring with National Geographic, in which we were talking about a single incident when the Roman legate, whose name was Varus, made his way from Syria all the way into Judea in the time well prior to the crucifixion and had 2,000 people crucified at once. it totally undermines the purpose if some of them walked away. This is not what the aim of the operation is. Another attempt to explain, or we might say explain away, the resurrection of Jesus is to say, well, maybe it was a case of mistaken identity. And the person who is often targeted as the likely suspect in this mistake is Simon of Cyrene, the person, it is said, who is compelled by the Romans to carry Jesus' cross when Jesus himself could not do it. Maybe because he was carrying the cross, they picked up the wrong guy and actually attached him to the cross. I sometimes think of this as the Monty Python theory, because it is remarkably like the life of Brian. And the reason for its implausibility is, once again, the Romans at this stage are committed to kill him, and they do. Of course, having said that, I also have to insist that the scene of Pontius Pilate in Matthew's gospel washing his hands and saying he's completely innocent of the act is also implausible. Pontius Pilate was the only authority there who could have brought this result about. So this then takes me to the other theme of today's remarks, namely how it is that we might describe the Gospels when they're dealing with Jesus' death and related matters as being ear witness testimony. I say ear witness as distinct from eyewitness for a reason. And it goes to the issue of what I referred to earlier on, namely the existence of sources inside the Gospels that actually produce the texts as we could read them today. What do I mean by a source? I'll give just one example. When Paul talks about his own conversion, he says that after it occurred, he went to visit Jerusalem, and in Jerusalem he saw only two people from the movement centered on Jesus. One was Peter, and the other was James, the brother of Jesus. And when he refers to that, he also explains that he consulted with them. He learned from them. He began to memorize their teaching concerning Jesus. This is an oral source in Aramaic, initially speaking, which eventually was incorporated with other sources in order to produce the Gospels as we know them. By the time we're finished with the entire series, I don't mean before Christmas, I mean before Easter, I hope to have explained each of the sources that influenced the Gospels, because each of them, in fact, is connected with one of the stories of Jesus' resurrection, as we will see. Now, when I was first approaching the Gospels in this way, during the period of my doctoral research, this is in the 1970s, I received a great deal of criticism by conservative evangelical scholars who said, oh no, that cannot be right, because really, when the Gospels were written, they were written in Greek, and the apostles themselves all spoke Greek. Since that time, this has not exactly appeared to be a likely proposition, especially not in the form that some of those scholars were arguing the idea. One of them, for example, posited that Matthew writes notes while he's with Jesus. Some of the notes are in Greek, some of them are in Aramaic, some of them are in Hebrew. It's like a little mini United Nations going all the way across Galilee. Today, more people would say that the initial sources of the Gospels were Aramaic, and over the course of time, they were translated into Greek, and finally incorporated within the Gospels as we can read them. But today, the argument has been taken up in a way that it was never intended to be, because now a book has been published called Jesus and the Eyewitnesses. And the idea is, I know, because these sources are in Aramaic, it must be that all of them were composed by people who were there. So it just shows you, therefore, we found another way to argue that the Gospels are entirely authentic. And that's why I want to insist that the existence of Aramaic sources doesn't actually tell us about eyewitnesses, it tells us about ear witnesses, by definition. Paul hears from Peter and from James. In this very passage from the Gospel according to Mark on page 2, you can see how very carefully the scene is set out in respect of its possible witnesses. The only eyewitnesses can't hear. In verse 40, there are women there. They are discerning from a distance. They're identified, and I'll refer to their identities as time goes on because they also play into the scene of the resurrection. But by definition, they can't hear. And this helps us to understand why in this central scene, the crucifixion, the fact is the Gospels vary. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are similar, but they're not identical. And for example, they portray different last words of Jesus. All of them cannot have been his last words. They portray the response of the crowd differently. And at the same time, they also show the interests of the early Christian community that used this source. It portrays the crucifixion as occurring at the third hour, 9 in the morning, and then at the sixth hour, verse 33, it becomes dark. So that at noontime, when you remember this source and Jesus' death, you would be fitting your own liturgical practice to your memory of these events. It contains some of the Aramaic of the source, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which can only be Aramaic, cannot be Hebrew, or any other Semitic language for that reason. So the source is actually built not simply from what an eyewitness sees, but also from the recollection of what we can know from a source and then hand on in the interests of a liturgical reconstruction, because in this case, as in the case of all the narratives within the Gospels, the interest is not in historical reconstruction. Historical reconstruction is a good thing. Some of us make a living from it. But that doesn't mean that every source is designed for that purpose, and we have very good indications here, in fact, that the sources are designed not for historical reminiscence or reconstruction, but rather for reenactment within the liturgical year. This helps us also to explain why it should be that of all people, in verse 39, it is the centurion, the Roman soldier, who sees how Jesus died and says, "Truly this man was God's son." The fact that Mark's gospel was written in Rome helps us to understand why you would want to put a Roman in the scene, in an important role. Within this same gospel, there is also identification of a character on the basis of his relationship to a person whose name was Rufus, also referred to in Paul's letter to the Romans. So sometimes literally local color makes its way into these depictions. And our understanding of sources permits us also to see why it should be that sometimes there are apparent disruptions in the text. Disruptions where a different source makes its presence felt within a given narrative. You can see this in particular if you compare Mark's depiction, which is the earliest, composed as we read it today, around the year 73 of the Common Era. We can discuss later on, if you like, why 73 appears to be the most plausible moment. If we compare Mark with a later gospel according to Matthew, probably written around the year 80. Largely, Matthew gives you a presentation comparable to Mark's, includes the Aramaic words of Jesus and many of the other elements. But then we have this very surprising addition, and you can see it just towards the bottom of the page, in verses 51 through 53. This is just where Mark simply has reference to the curtain in the temple being split, back in Mark, verse 38. You notice, by the way, how the issue of the temple, which had been the pivot of Jesus' execution, is built into the narrative of the crucifixion. But in addition to that notice in Mark, Matthew also has, from verse 52, bottom of the page, "And the memorials were opened, and many bodies of the holy ones who slept were raised. They came out from the memorials after his raising and entered into the holy city and were manifested to many." Matthew uniquely has reference not simply to Jesus' resurrection, but to the resurrection of many bodies of the holy ones. It refers to it inside the story of the crucifixion, and yet it also specifically says that this occurred after Jesus' resurrection. There's an interruption, not only as compared to Mark, there's also an interruption in the timeline that Matthew itself presents. That is an indication that we're dealing with an alternative source. So alongside what we might describe as being a standard story of Jesus' crucifixion that sees it as preliminary to the resurrection which is going to occur, and where the link is given you by the women who see the crucifixion and are going to visit the tomb, you have the presentation in Matthew where the scene of the crucifixion is interrupted by a literally apocalyptic event. According to this particular reference in Matthew, the general resurrection of the holy ones, the saints, has already begun. It's a major transformation in time, such as is predicted, for example, in the book of Zechariah, which featured centrally in Jesus' orientation towards the temple. That's to indicate that when I refer to ear witness testimony, it means that we're dealing with genuine sources, but that does not imply by any stretch that the sources are all written by eyewitnesses or that they agree. This presentation of the crucifixion cannot be right in both these ways. Ultimately, someone who looks at the sources historically is going to have to decide between one presentation and another. But our initial task is to understand just what these sources are saying and why they are saying it, so that I'll be arguing over the course of this series and then again in the spring that we can make sense of why this kind of statement is made, but in the end, as critical readers, even as we can make sense of what they say, the demand is also present that we determined what kind of sense we would like to make of the events. All this, in turn, has to be fitted into what is alluded to already by the presence of the women. As I say, they are also involved in the interment of Jesus. So next week, we'll be dealing with the particular question of Jesus' burial. And this takes us into more recent controversies. Where was the burial? Is it, in fact, in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre? Or does the Pope go to the wrong place every year? Is it, in fact, in the Kidron Valley, near where the tomb of Caiaphas was discovered? Or is it further from the temple still, in a place called Talpiot, where it has recently been argued that we have discovered not only the ossuary, the bone box of Jesus, but also the bone box of Jesus' wife and child? Or are all of these designations incorrect? Because really, the Romans threw all of their victims to the dogs. The argument most famously made recently by John Dominic Crossan. So as you can see, we should have a very good time next week. Thank you very much indeed. Yes, please, Tess. Excellent. The question is, I repeat, for the sake of the Cardinal of Red Hook, who is hearing is a little, why the year 73, should I say, for the Gospel according to Mark? It is quite true that you will read in many kind of standard handbooks of the New Testament that Gospel according to Mark is written C70, circa 70. Why 70? And with this basic analysis, I thoroughly agree. The Gospel according to Mark, as written, as distinct from the perspective of Jesus, assumes that the temple in Jerusalem has been destroyed, which occurred in the year 70 as a result of the Roman siege under Titus and the burning of Jerusalem. So I have nothing to argue with my colleagues when they say C70, except it seems to me we can go further than that, because there are very clear marks that this gospel was written in Rome. I refer to Roman personnel being identified with the text. There is also a feature of Mark's Greek, which is known as itticism, which means that Mark's Greek is affected by syntax of the early Latin language, as well as sometimes by the Aramaic language. So these are signs that it was actually composed in Rome, which is what various scholars from the second century of the Common Era have been saying. I should also point out that Mark's gospel urges on disciples exactly the kind of comportment that you'd expect in Rome. It wants them to keep silent. It wants them not to be too garrulous about the gospel. And in Rome, after the pogrom of Nero in the year 64, that is precisely the profile a disciple should take. But finally, then, I pose the question, when do I, in Rome, know the temple was destroyed? You see, it's fine, we know that it was destroyed in 70. They were not all watching CNN. And this is a reference that not only works inside Mark as an allusion to an important historical event, this is a major part of the construction of the gospel. We in Rome know, as a matter of fact, that the temple was destroyed. when Titus marches the prisoners from Jerusalem through Rome. And that occurs in the year 73. You see, the temple was destroyed in 70, but the revolt went on until 73. And in fact, the earliest depiction there is of the elements inside the temple occurs on what is called the Arch of Titus in Rome. Titus made a triumphal arch for himself, and he depicted the priests in chains, the incense altar, the menorah, and the vessels being borne by the high priest. Anyone who could see that triumphal arch would know what had occurred. You didn't have to read any inscription. You didn't have to be an historian. You knew that something earth-shattering had occurred. And this is what then is incorporated within the gospel according to Mark. So I would say that just as we can say that the Arch of Titus was dedicated in 73, so Mark's gospel saw the light of day in the same year. Yes, please, Melissa. The question is whether the Gospels agree on the seven last words of Christ, and the answer is no. That's why they're seven. In other words, what we traditionally call the seven last words of Christ are culled from the Gospels and then put together. But within each individual Gospel, there's one set of last words. It's a very good question because it shows the way in which liturgical practice influenced the Gospels, but then once the Gospels were written, they influenced liturgical practice.
Yes, we were talking about
Jesus'
Psalm,
Father-wise,
itself, the
Savior. Mm-hmm. The Psalm 22 is actually cited by Jesus on the cross, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why have you forsaken me? It is not, as is frequently portrayed, some kind of unique outburst of despair. It's actually a usage of the psalm meditatively during a period of suffering, which winds up by saying at the climax of the psalm, I will give thanks to you in the great congregation. That is, it looks to vindication coming about as the capstone of this psalm. What I would suggest is that there is a prophetic line that runs through Psalm 22, but it is not specific to someone being crucified. It does refer to physical suffering, to the malice of outsiders, and to ultimate vindication, and therefore it's entirely appropriate to Jesus' situation. But I would not say that the psalm as such specifically prophesies the events concerning Jesus. Yes, please, you had a question. Excellent. That's good. What is the significance of 6 hour in verse 33 in particular of Mark 14? The 6 hour means noon. So, because you count by the sun. That is, the third hour is when ordinarily you go to work. The first hour is when you wake up. The sixth hour is noon. Ninth hour is the afternoon. and so forth. So to say the sixth hour, when the sun should be at its height, it became dark upon the whole earth until the ninth hour. And incidentally, that detail is picked up in a later gospel, not in the New Testament, called the Gospel According to Peter. And it's embellished so that it's so dark that people can only make their way by candlelight and lanterns. This is an example of ear witnessing. That's right. Every effort has been made, and as far as I can see, they're good efforts to understand when solar eclipses occurred during the ancient period. As it happens, I spent a very productive sabbatical a couple of years ago taking a course that I missed as a student in astronomy. And it was a good thing that I missed it as a student, because now the textbook is much better. And it comes with a computer program that permits you to turn back the skies and to see what anyone would have seen of the stars and the planets at any moment in history. And sometimes there is something of a correlation with the Gospels, and sometimes there's not. So, for example, the Star of Bethlehem. There is a conjunction that occurs between Jupiter and Mars in the early centuries, early years of the first century of the Common Era. So that, and it, because it's a conjunction, that's also movable. And if you were observing this from the east side of the Sea of Galilee, you might well think something is going on. Does that mean the wise men saw it? I think not. It means there was such a conjunction. And it's folded into the ear witness presentation. So sometimes you can find elements which bear a relationship to what we have within the Gospels. But this solar eclipse is not recorded. Not recorded. The giant earthquake of Matthew is not recorded. It's hard to hide these things if in fact they occurred. And so that does cause the question to arise, is there therefore a symbolic usage of darkness which over course of time is turned into the literal failure of the sun? That is one way to understand what's going on as one source develops into another and finally is incorporated within the Gospels. And we'll see some other examples of that as time goes on. Yes, please. Mm-hmm. So why should there be any doubt about Jesus' last words? I mean, did he finally say, as in John's Gospel, "Tetelestai, it is accomplished"? Did he say, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani"? Did he say, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit," in Luke? Why should there be any doubt? This text itself is telling you why there's doubt. The only witnesses are the women who are at a distance. They actually can't hear. The men have made themselves scarce. They have run. That is part of the unanimous testimony of the Gospels. So it virtually had to be the case that there would be doubt about what Jesus' final words were. And One thing also, I think, can be said with a fair degree of confidence, you cannot say different things as your last words, and it is also not likely that he said them all. At some stage or another, people are making educated guesses. Psalm 22 fits. The fit with the occasion might actually be producing the memory of that particular wording. Yes, please.
Does the recent discovery of the tomb of Caiaphas, has it been established that this is the Caiaphas of the Gospel?
Excellent question. Is the tomb of Caiaphas our Caiaphas? And in this case, we can be much more certain about the find than we can about certain other finds that I'll refer to next week. It was a matter of simple luck that while an area was being cleared to the south of the Temple Mount, the bulldozer took the top off a natural cave. It turns out when the workers looked down and they saw ossuaries, that is, limestone bone boxes with bones in them. More fortunate still that when they saw these, they called the Israel Antiquities Authority, which immediately dispatched archaeologists who took control of the site, made sure that it was intact. Nothing was added to or taken from what was inside tunnels carved in this cave. One of them was, as we call it, the ossuary of Caiaphas. His name is actually carved in stone in the way that one would in antiquity when you were putting a loved one's bones in a bone box. See, ordinarily, at this period in Jerusalem, the person's body would be laid out on a shelf inside the cave. And it would stay there for approximately a year until the flesh had decomposed. And then the bones could be gathered, and if you were wealthy, they'd be put into a box. It's a mark of status to be in a box. If you don't have a box, there's also a common burial pit. I think of it as our cemetery up the hill, which I call ultimate tenure. So if you're of a high level of status, you go in the bone box, and then you want to know, well, wait a minute, which one is Uncle Caiaphas's? And therefore, you inscribe his name, but it's kind of a scrawled inscription. It's not carved in, it's scrawled on the side and on the long face. There are several interesting features about this particular ossuary. Although most ossuaries of this period, first century of the Common Era, are completely plain and unornamented, this ossuary has carved into it properly now symbolisms of the rosette and the palm tree, which were associated with the temple. From the spot where this ossuary was found, if you stand on that spot and turn, you look directly at the temple, just a mile away. And finally, Caiaphas' name is given on the ossuary according to his name given only in Jewish sources. He was not only called Caiaphas, he was called Joseph Caiaphas. You would never know that from the New Testament. The New Testament just refers to him as Caiaphas. So the fact that he's referred to in a way that accords with rabbinic literature shows us that we're dealing with the way his remains were cared for by his own family. So there we have a very clear first century burial site. We also have an indication of how old it is, because some kind person dropped his change in the area of the cave. And one of the coins can be identified as coming from the time of Herod Agrippa in the year 42. In Caiaphas' bone box was found the bones of a man approximately 65 years old, according to forensic anthropologists. One could argue that there was more than one Joseph Caiaphas, that maybe the more than one associated with the temple. This is not a matter of complete certainty. But the number of indications that there are that come together and suggest this indeed is the tomb of Caiaphas is quite striking. Since Caiaphas, as high priest, was actually the person who presided over what was called the Sanhedrin, that is, the local council of Jewish authorities in Jerusalem, we now know the area where the Sanhedrin could expect burial. Joseph of Arimathea was a member of that same Sanhedrin. So it could be that the tomb of Caiaphas is giving us an indication where we should conceive of Jesus' burial having taken place. But next week I'll compare that, what I would say, rather clear finding with statements made about other sites. And I will make invidious comparisons. Yes, please. Yeah, excellent question. Why is it that we would find in Matthew, for example, the kind of creativity that we do, the earthquake, the appearance of many bodies of the saints in Jerusalem? And I'll give you another example of this. This comes as a result of another phone call I had actually just yesterday about an interview. Would I please come to New York to talk about what Mary and Joseph would have seen on their way into Egypt when they were fleeing Herod the Great? We're asking you as an historian, they said. We are also talking to a priest and an anthropologist. I didn't bother telling them I'm a priest because I thought they'd become terribly upset. Because as it was, I had to explain to them, I'll come down to New York, I'll be there anyway, but you understand, along with practically every New Testament scholar, I don't believe the flight to Egypt occurred. I don't think, I've been around pregnant women. You don't walk them to Egypt and back. I don't care who you are. I know Joseph was very patient. This actually doesn't compute. So the issue therefore arises, where does Matthew get this from? Well, I mentioned the flight to Egypt because Matthew tells you where he gets it from. Matthew says to you, this occurred in order to fulfill what was spoken, out of Egypt have I called my son, from the book of Hosea. Because in Matthew's understanding, everything that occurs in connection with Jesus fulfills aspects of the Hebrew Bible. This is what leads to Matthew's reputation of being a gospel designed for Jewish consumption. But beware, the final words of Matthew are, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. This too is a hard sell in a synagogue. So he is talking about Jewish identity, no question about it. He does have Jesus say to his disciples, while he's alive, go only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Do not go into the way of the Gentiles. But then at the moment of the resurrection, and we'll discuss this in due course, at the moment of the resurrection, Matthew changes that perspective quite radically because he believes this is a part of the fulfillment of Scripture. Fulfilling the Scripture becomes the program of the gospel. Not verisimilitude. It's as if a lively sense of geography has been replaced by a sense of this theme of the fulfillment of Scripture. And in Damascus, where I think it was written, Matthew is living very close to the community known as the Essenes. The Essenes had a major community in Damascus, just as they did on the Dead Sea, and just as they did in Jerusalem, and just as they did in Alexandria. If you read the literature of the Essenes, you will see that they too were engaged in the enterprise of explaining how Scripture fulfilled the expectation of their leader, who is called the teacher of righteousness. So here's an example of a text which is not governed by an effort at historical reconstruction, because the issue of scriptural fulfillment has completely taken over and pushed aside every other consideration. I think I'd better stop there and say we'll pick up next week. They'll all be about for questions as well. Thank you.